Today I'm with my good friend Daniel, and this will be his first proper introduction to anarchism. Right, well, we've known each other for quite some time.
Yeah. We've had conversations.
We've had conversations. And mostly, I guess, funny stuff kind of revolves around Rick and Morty, I would say. who also happens to be anti-government, right?
He's anti-everything.
He's anti-everything, right, right. The Council of Ricks, it's like, you guys were so afraid of government that you guys came together and formed your own government, and that makes me the Rickest Rick of Ricks.
Right, yes. Makes sense, yeah.
So there's an interesting appeal there. We have, I guess, a good history and good rapport, and now it's, I think, finally time to have that conversation, right? We're going to the Freedom Gatherings. You're among here now with other anarchists. So I guess it's time to pop your cherry, to speak.
I'm clenching my butthole.
Now you gotta stick it way up your ass there. So the best way to start this would be, I usually do a three-question format.
Right.
Yeah. And that kind of reveals what your moral positions are.
Yeah.
Right. Because I wouldn't presume to know or whatnot. And then from there, you'll find some terms that we define. And then from there, I could paint the brush of the picture of how government is immoral. Right. Pretty much the argument against the state.
That's fair.
The format. Right. Yes, and then we can go into all the different questions or your thoughts or comments or anything like that. Kind of like boxing. All right, before you guys fight, you know, let's go over the rules, right? So, not to blow the waist, no ear biting Mike Tyson. God dang, he did it twice in a row.
Taking my number one rhetorical skill away. They won't listen. Bite their fucking ear.
That's right, dude. It works for me. All right, so we're going to first question.
Okay.
In your day-to-day life, do you use violence to solve your personal problems?
No.
Right? And violence would define as, like, placing a person in an involuntary position without their consent of choice, i.e. rape, murder, assault, and all that bad stuff. Violation of self-ownership. I own my body, right? The second question then would be, would you, with the areas outside of self-defense, right, would you consider then wrong or moral to initiate force?
No.
No? Give me a...
I think that healthy force, like in justifiable force, makes sense to me. I think that there are individuals that operate outside of the rules of humankind, and I think, or in general, outside the rules of civilized society. That
can you provide an example?
Yeah, where, absolutely.
And that is not an act of self-defense of yourself and others, right? The initiation of force would be like violence, right? Initiating the aggression onto someone. Like, self-defense is not the initiation of force. It's defending yourself from the initiation of force.
I mean, today alone, I had an individual who was behaving poorly in my place of business, and I forced them out of my business.
Well,
I had to do that. They didn't touch me. They didn't hurt me. But they were causing a commotion. They were behaving improperly as human beings, and they were most likely distracting my business, so I forced them to leave.
Okay, so they asked them to leave, right?
Like, I told them to leave, and then they refused to leave. And then
now they're initiating force. Now that's trespassing, right?
Well, yeah, I mean...
Now you're acting in self-defense, though, from that initiation of force.
That's a fair assessment, but I think that there's a lot of other situations, you know. But in general, I personally am not a forceful person.
Right.
Unless somebody does...
Like in his state, right? He's the moment, like, you can grant, give, and withdraw permission at any time over your property, right? If I own, this is my house, and I have guests that are coming in, and now they're acting in a way that is unwelcoming, like being rude and mean or being an asshole to my other friends.
Right, yeah.
I say, well, I'm withdrawing your permission now to be on my property.
Yeah.
If they refuse, now they're initiating force and aggressing, right? Trespassing on my property.
Right.
Now I can act to remove them. I'm acting self-defense now from his aggression.
Yes.
Right? So what you did then was not initiating force. The person who said no, right, this is not your place. This is like, people have to look at business as an extension of like your own home.
Right.
Right. This is just one that you just kind of welcome everyone to come in, right, to trade.
Right.
So I wouldn't count that then as initiating force. That's you defending yourself.
Okay, that's fair.
Right. All right, so examining the question then, and perhaps other examples, would you consider then, because that would apply as defending yourself from the initiation of force.
Well, my thing is that I operate within the confines of a law-abiding society, and the law-abiding society is held together, in my opinion, by the potential of force, or by the the implication of force, the idea that if you do not obey the rules, that force will be used against you in some way. And I think that's the same way with property value, though. Like, I mean, or property rights, rather. If somebody comes into my store and says, hey, you know, this or that, and, you know, I'm not going to obey what your rules, I'm going to cause your property damage, then I am utilizing self-government, but I am, you know, exerting my will regarding my property rights over somebody else.
Well, for example, in situations which they initiate force, like in rape, and you're defending yourself to exert force back, you're not initiating, you're defending yourself. You're not raping them back.
Yeah,
you are,
no, that's absolutely
right,
true, yeah.
Defending yourself against a person who continues to seek now to violate your consent, right? Because you've withdrawn your consent, and he seeks to continue to press that.
Right.
Right? And also, like, rules, we'll get into that, right?
Yeah, that's fine.
All of that stuff.
We can move on.
Yeah, before we can move on, though, would you consider it, then, wrong or moral to initiate force outside of areas of self-defense of yourself and others?
I think it's a gray area, still.
Gray areas, you can't have gray areas without acknowledgement that there are white and black areas, right? You can't have grays without black and whites. Then that would mean that you acknowledge that there are positions in which areas that there is consent or there is no consent,
right?
You advocate one or the other. Gray areas try to befuddle the area in the middle.
Right.
And that I find to be the most valuable thing that we can uphold as virtuous people with one another. Is there consent in that relationship or there is not? Go ahead.
I'm sorry. I'm not one. I don't promote an agenda of preemptive violence generally.
Right.
Like, I think the justification for the Iraq War was fairly thin, bogusly thin.
Well, let's look back at you as the individual.
Yeah.
Right? And then we'll go look at other examples.
I personally don't think I'd ever preemptively use the force. Unless, like,
You wouldn't consider it. You would consider it thinking that it would be initiation. In a situation where you see, like, someone being attacked.
Yeah.
Right? In a situation where someone says, help, right? Get off of me, right? That's not you initiating, because that falls into self-defense.
I feel like if somebody, and yeah, I guess it is in a way self-defense in any situation. I would have no problem in, like, initiating legal proceedings or something like that, being the one who pushes in that way. I think that those kind of things, I don't think I have much qualm about.
All right.
I can push through a situation if I think that I'm being mistreated or somebody's not respecting me in some way or my life.
right. I guess the most easiest way to kind of break down the question would be, would you consider it wrong and immoral to violate consent?
Yes.
Right. And that's where the initiation force does. Right. The initiation force seeks to violate the consent of someone. You act to defend yourself and that of others from that initiation force that seeks to violate consent.
And I can, personally, it's my personal, individual.
You as the individual.
Activity,
right.
Yes. I see that as an issue. Broadly, more politically, so
it's in those areas we will examine.
Yeah,
right.
So personally, yes, I believe that I would have to be some form of megalomaniac to believe that my individual needs and desires supersede the individual needs and desires of other people. But then I think when you come into the needs of multiple people versus individual people, that's when I see different prayers, and you can do the trolley problem thing and all that, right? If you want to do it. That's another story entirely.
Those are crazy trolleys, I'm telling you. I wake up, I'm right there.
It's like, man, every day, a fucking trolley, man. I don't even know.
I saw a funny meme where saying, like this guy picks up the phone, he's like, hey, I can't find my family. It's like, yeah, that's what I'm trying to talk to you about. There's a problem here that's tied up on the tracks. So I don't know what to tell you.
It's like Liam Neeson every day. It's
right.
Like, you know. Taken.
Charlie the Engine, you know, on roids, getting ready to run him over.
It'd be a really weird Taken 4. It's just Liam Neeson at the hands of a trolley switch and has to switch it every time to kill a terrorist or else his daughter will die.
Right. All right, so then we'll go right there from the second. You find it wrong or moral to initiate force, which would be violating consent.
Right, for my personal life.
You as an individual.
Yeah.
Then we can only speak for us as an individual. I can't speak for others. And then the last question would be, would you also therefore consider it wrong or immoral to violently force your ideas onto other people? Like, if you didn't like what I had to say, you could ignore me, walk away, ostracize me.
Yeah, in my personal life, yes.
Right. If I came after you, though, when you walked away and held a gun to your head, said, no, you have to do what I have to say, right?
Yeah, that's wrong, yes.
Right. Versus, like, philosophy, discussion, getting to a better place. Right.
Yes, and like I said, in personal life, yeah.
Beautiful. Right. All right, so in your day-to-day life, then, you have a plurality of nonviolent solutions you apply and use to solve your problems. You have this moral integrity against that violence. And as a community of individual people here in Richmond, though, we're taught many times, told repeatedly, that the only way we can affect any kind of change and make any difference, though, is through government, politics, vote, they say, right?
Absolutely, yeah.
So people vote with their ideas, opinions, and preferences on how best to solve those community problems. And in effect, they elect a politician. That politician, then, his early job is to legislate those ideas and opinions into law. And then those laws of opinions are then backed and enforced by the police at gunpoint. And you can take government opinion that cannabis is bad for everyone, right? Mm-hmm. If I were to smoke a plant, I would be kidnapped, arrested, thrown into a cage, a prison. And which point, at any point I refuse or resist or try to run away and escape, if I could, I'd be met with more violence or sometimes shot, murdered. At the same time, governments are even found into more violence because at no point can you say, I do want to help the poor, but I don't want to fund war. You have no freedom of economic choice. You still have to give government your money. You still have to give up your property. You still have to pay your taxes.
Yes.
Because if you did have a freedom of economic choice on how best to spend your own money, how best to allocate your own resources, government then wouldn't threaten to send you to another cage if you didn't pay your taxes.
Yeah.
So then this is how then government is immoral, the argument against the state, and that this organization then only knows how to solve problems the one way, a singular way, and that's through the threat of and use of violence to solve any problems versus the plurality of nonviolent solutions that you and I already share.
See, my perspective here, though, is that while government performs immoral acts, they are necessary immoralities and necessary evils, as it would be. The idea that a society can exist without a de facto state seems kind of counterintuitive to me in general, like almost oxymoronical, like just has no... It doesn't, like, a stateless society, just, yeah, it's an oxymoron. And
so let's define what is a state or government, then.
Well,
right?
A state is a group of, is a binding factor of society, and it holds it together, and it makes people, it leverages violence against individuals who would perpetuate violence against other people, or who wish to, whose pursuit of individual liberty would cause great or even moderate unpleasantness for large numbers of people. Specifically, like, you know, needs of many outweigh the needs of few.
Like the utilitarian thing, right?
I would say I'm very utilitarian in nature, and like I'm a social anarchist, as I've come to label myself, I think. I have absolutely no belief in social laws. And you quote things like the marijuana thing. I absolutely believe that's wrong, and I believe that I work for government too. But I think that, like, the idea that a rapist should go free is kind of crazy.
Well, okay, so now we want to go discussing how legal systems would work, right, in the absence of
right.
the government, right? That seems like to be some of the questions that you have. You know, a rapist being free. Here you have many times a lot of people being free for all kinds of crimes that...
Oh, yeah,
you know,
absolutely. It's not perfect.
Obama murdering someone overseas without a due process of trial, through embalming them, right? Versus due process there, right?
Yeah.
A lot of people escape with murder as long as they call it something else. If you were to blow up something around here, they'll call that a terrorism act. If the government does it, they'll call it collateral damage, right? Now, when I talk about government and look at it more objectively, like as a state, the state is a group of individual people who advocate for the initiation of force.
Right.
Government in itself is just the flavor of how that force is carried out. But what government then is in more objectively is just there are a monopoly, series of monopolies on the services you and I want. Government has a monopoly on roads, on law, on security, on arbitration. ABC is a monopoly. Right, on liquor, distilled spirits. It's illegal and criminal for anyone to compete against their wholesale retail sale of distilled spirits. You look at the post office, it's a monopoly on delivering pieces of paper. It's illegal and criminal for FedEx, UPS, and DHL to compete in the market in delivering pieces of paper. They can only deliver packages. And that's all that government is. They do not allow us to have the economic freedom to cancel or unsubscribe as we would from any real business service, like when Netflix tried to increase their prices 2 years ago or overnight. People are like, yeah, cancel, unsubscribe, and go to Hulu. You have options. You can go anywhere else. When government does it, you can't go anywhere else because it's also illegal and criminal for any one of us to compete entrepreneurially in order to say, I can provide you a better service of security. It's not going to be abusive or harmful to you, the consumer.
I think the issue that I see, and this is the one that I've had explained to you many times, it just never, ever seems to work out for me, in my opinion, is the idea of detention and how I don't feel like there's any way to detain somebody in an anarchist society. And the idea that the penalty for serial murder or something of that nature is ostracization.
That's just the penalty.
What?
That's not just the penalty. It could be.
Well, I'm saying the idea that a serial murderer could just kill people and then just retreat to his location in the middle of nowhere and live off the land before he goes and kills somebody else. That's
all right. So, what do we do about murderers? Is your question then?
Yeah.
Like I said, I would say the first way we would resolve and creating a structural organization or a civilized society is first by setting up the rules that we have that against initiation of force, because the way that is handled here, in order for government to go after murderers, they must first threaten your life to murder you if you don't surrender your property.
Right.
And then we can go after murderers.
Right.
Or it's like theft. It's wrong for you to steal, but we'll call it taxes. Or if we're going to go after thieves because stealing is wrong, then you so first stop stealing from me, right, and apply that universally to gonna go after thieves, right?
But who does this?
Okay, so so what you have, like you look at Virginia. Virginia is one monopolized community, right? Mm-hmm. The majority of preference forced into the minority. The abolishment of government allows the freedom to have thousands of free societies based on consent, catering to your lifestyle preferences. Now you can have all these different communities with different rules, respect for property rights. Like the rules in here in this house, don't transcend across the river to Johnny's place, right? And from there, though, people moving into these communities, they have real explicit contracts,
right?
So it says here, well, if I were to aggress someone, if I were, you know, I'd have to pay them out. Here's the consequences, right? And consequences were different from one community to the next. But here are the rules, right? If you get caught cheating, right, you're expelled from the school. Plagiarism, right? If you steal in this community, like the Amish community, the only thing they have is a social ostracism. There's like people who murdered a couple Amish in their school like a few years ago didn't seek out, I mean, the government put them away and settled what the consequences would be, but for the Amish, for them to just pray for him, forgive him, and that was their way of, in that community, to handle such things. Other communities will be different. If someone in that member of that community were to assault someone, he already gave explicit consent to what the consequences would be. It could be beheading if he wanted to, right? In extreme cases, it could be even a soft case, a pillow fight. It could be, a fine, a penalty. It could be you have to make reparations. The only person really who has much of any say, though, is the victim to decide what the reparations are, right? And that can also be in the contract as well.
But what contract? I mean, you're talking about somebody crossing into a community, mm-hmm. I'm assuming, like a group of people who have all agreed to a set group of rules, and they've all decided to pay the same person for security, I'm assuming, basically, or
I guess,
the same group of individuals for security.
It could be like that.
And that same group of individuals has their own set of rules and everything of that nature. And in my opinion, that's just a de facto government.
Well, the difference is, the difference between a business and like ABC is that you're forced to fund ABC, right? There's guns pointed at people to fund it. There's no guns pointed at anyone to fund security.
What if all of a sudden that security decides
to fund? All right, so we'll get to the area of security. That's a good area to get into.
Well, I mean, that's the exact... linchpin there.
Okay, so the area of security is a good one. So what about violence in a free and voluntary society, right? There's a lot of different ways to kind of tackle that question. You know, what about, like, we want to prevent... serial killers, who want to prevent murderers and a lot of these violent people to come out of nowhere. And the reality is they don't really spring out of nowhere like dwarves, right? It's from the ground.
Right.
There is a history of violence that follows that, right? Things don't magically appear. There's always a series of events to lead up to that, which is why it's tantamount part of the thing that we advocate for is also peaceful parenting, right? You have to universalize that. It's not just the violence that government does to us. It's also the violence we do to each other. And most importantly, the violence is done to children. that is a language that they'll pick up and learn and realize, well, I guess it's a viable solution because they beat me up whenever they think something's wrong or I didn't follow their directions. And you'll find like places, people like Jeffrey Dahmer. People say, oh, look, he didn't have any violence growing up. No, his parents just always spanked him, beat him up all the time, right? The average child, like a 4 years old, gets hit over 900 times, beaten over 900 times.
Right.
But people don't look at that as calling for what it is. Oh, it's just discipline.
Now, I'm not worried about the propagation of violence.
Well,
look,
this is how we stop future serial killers, right?
Yeah.
Now, like your first question, what about a random serial murderer, right? Now, say that I'm in the business for 20 years providing security, and this community golf course community needs a security company. I'll put in my bid. I'll tell them, hey, look, I've been in the business for 20 years. I've always detained people if they ever, you know, never have to shoot anyone. You can also, I'll throw in a guarantee that you can check my ammunitions and everything, like, make sure I don't have an extra single bullet, right? I'll throw in $1 million if anyone can, you know, can find anything that says otherwise, right? Then you have a lot of competing contracts of security saying the same thing. Well, I've been in the business for 25 years, right? And we'll provide the best package and services. Look at all these customer reviews and all these different communities we provided security for, and no complaints. That kind of market competition drives up quality, lowers the cost of this.
My question is, though, what happens when all of your options are bad?
What do you mean?
What happens if you don't have those options? What happens if you have an absence of power, and that absence of power, these security contractors decide that they want the power, and then they seize control of the power, and then they band together and they form their own government, and basically they force that government upon other people.
Well, let's start from the beginning from there. So you're saying like...
I'm saying like failed state economics, which you're looking at with, and failed state diplomacy, like you see when failed states fail. There's always warlords that provide security, like, oh, I will I'll give you this security package, and it's just like the mob offering their protection schemes, you know, and stuff like that. And they just go, it's just basically extortion.
Well, there were never private business to begin with.
It doesn't matter, though.
I think it kind of does matter.
I get that, but what I'm saying, I'm thinking about this, not like within the concept of the actual ideology. I respect the ideology. It's beautiful. It's lovely. It's articulate and it's pretty. But the problem that I see is that reality works outside of ideology. Reality doesn't care about ideology.
These people don't know about anarchy.
Well, I understand.
People in Somalia have never heard about anarchy.
1 in 100 people is a sociopath or a psychopath. 1 in 100 people. And, you know, some people say that's not enough to really cause a big problem. Well, the biggest problem in America right now is that 1 in 100 people own pretty much the entire country. And,
well, I don't know what the statistics or facts of that would be to show that they are sociopathic. I wouldn't know. But even if they are...
Well, I mean, it's sociopathy and psychopathy are just... They're not learned behaviors. They're absolute mental disorders that cause people to have absolutely no interest in the...
Which is fine.
In the public interest. Yeah. They seek only to... sociopaths can be very productive
functioning
members,
right,
of society,
yeah,
because...
Surgeons are kind of sociopathic. They have to disassociate from their emotions, from the...
Yeah. Yeah. And you can do that. Psychopaths cannot. Psychopaths will just... impulsively do whatever they want and wreak havoc upon society. But like, even when you go past that, like these cults of personality, individuals, society have a natural tendency to group together, from tribalism to modern cultures and modern empires. And I see as very improbable that a group of people would ever decide to just live without government, totally. They might do that at first. They might say, yeah, let's do that. And then I see that people will say, well, there's no government, so there's not really anything protecting me or preventing me from going and exerting force against a group of people using my large group of individuals, my army, basically, and conquering. And the idea, that all anarchy, like, in order for anarchy to work, that everything would have to be anarchic, just that seems also, like, really, really difficult.
Let's go back to the first question. We're going over the place here. Because you're talking about, what about warlords? Because the thing is, if government doesn't, like breaks your legs, and all of a sudden they're gone, yeah, it's going to be difficult to learn how to walk all of a sudden, right? When the whole time you've been dependent on them. They've never teach you how to be independent. They don't teach you how to be entrepreneurs, right? It's going to be difficult for people to know what to do next. Because all they've been taught in 12 years of indoctrination camps is that government, 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 government.
Why do you think government doesn't teach people to be entrepreneurs? If the government is going to make money on tax revenue, if an entrepreneurship was a really was a valuable tool. Why wouldn't they teach kids to be entrepreneurs?
They need people to be dependent on government.
I disagree with that. I think that's a characterization of government.
Yes.
That I just disagree with.
Reading levels has gone down tremendously since government has monopolized that. When you graduate from high school, you have no marketing skills. The most you can make, of course, so many people get angry. It's like, yeah, minimum wage, because government does not teach you when you go to their schools, nothing. Yeah, I went through and learned nothing of value.
And we have a huge problem in America because we have a two-party system where one party is trying to sabotage the government while the other party is trying to make it better. And I think that that's kind of innately the problem here. It's not that government itself is bad. It is inefficient, just as...
Well, government against...
Any kind of organization is inefficient.
All right, so let's go solve the problem of security. Say in a free society now, right? You have market competition.
Right.
You have a business to provide security. You go to this community here, it's 420 friendly, so I'll provide you security.
Right.
You've been doing this for 10 years, and now you as the CEO
say
all of a sudden, well, we've been doing great, profits are great, we're hiring all these employees. Now it's time to go warlord mode, right? So you run into several problems already as the CEO. Your shareholders will say, get this guy out of here, fire him, right? Because we have contracts with other people saying we're not going to go war mode, because that would ruin our reputation. Everyone, all the competing security companies are waiting for someone like me, for us to mess up, so they could take our place in the market and get that share, right? And the moment you go warlord mode, it takes a lot of logistics to fund those supplies and resources. You no longer have internet. You no longer have running water. You no longer have anything of utilities. No company is going to want to say that, yes, we provide customer services to terrorists, right? People who...
Well, they do it in third world countries every day.
I mean,
ISIS, they've taken over dams.
Yeah, you ever talk about governments? Yeah, these are governments. Yeah, absolutely.
Yeah,
these are status. Yeah, status will state. Yeah, there's no...
But that's what I'm saying. What's preventing a security contractor from building a state?
Then let me show you more of an example, okay? You can look... One, I wouldn't say they were completely capitalistic because they turn a lot more into status near the end, but you can look at the largest security company in the world were the Pinkertons, and they outnumber the government. More men than the army. And tell me, what is the territory that they conquered with their private
security? I don't know who the Pinkertons are.
You never heard of Pinkertons?
So
the Pinkertons were before the FBI. So in the 1800s, they would go out there and capture bank robbers, heists, and stuff like that.
Are we talking about like marshals or something of that nature?
No, these are just private investigative detectives, right? And they grew in such a large amount of size with such great services that they were providing to many people. The government started contracting them, and then eventually they just had more men, more of their service armed than the United States Army, than the entire government. But there was no territory that they ever conquered. There's no slice of the country that they ever set themselves forth and says, now we are kings. The thing with private individuals or businesses that try to attempt to do that is that at any time, people can just, cancel, unsubscribe. Your whole entire infrastructure of getting profits to sustain that collapses, done, gone.
Yeah. Issue is, though, that these individuals have no accountability at this point. Like, in a democracy, it is barely functional as it is. We still have a modicum of accountability. If a politician doesn't behave correctly or according to our wishes, we can actually have them impeached. We can have recall elections, or we can just choose not to elect them in the future.
Well, the thing is, what business does anyone have saying that they can run your life and telling you what you can, cannot do with your property, what you can, cannot put in your body?
I think that's the fundamental disconnect here. Is it that I believe that there are individuals that are not necessarily individuals, but large groupings of individuals that have to shape laws and leverage force in order to prevent individuals, some of which who don't even have any idea what is in their best interest. From
you know another individual's best interest and to force that upon him?
No. I'm not saying that that the government knows individual people's best interest,
right.
But they know or they have the ability to at least try to determine the group's best interest or to act in the best interest of an economy. You know, we live in America where we've had one of the most robust economies in the world. It's shrinking dramatically as the market has taken, work to individuals who are more willing to work for less. We see that happening, like as a free market adjustment or whatever. And
there's no free market.
The economy would beg to differ. But, I mean, there's still the free exchange of goods and labor.
Market is respect for property rights. When a group of strangers can tell you what you can do with your product and steal a little off the top for everything that you produce and create, and then restrict in the way that you want to trade voluntary between individuals that have no business involving themselves in, that's a state-controlled market.
That's a different definition of free market than I think most people would have. But
most people have been lied to, misled, and have improper definitions. They think the source of contract is a real intangible document, but you can't show it to me.
Well, no, it's not. Yeah, I don't think anybody believes that. I hope not, at least.
Well, that's what they do. It's like people go up to say, well, the source of contract, and I would say, show it to me.
The social contract is an abstract concept.
Doesn't exist.
No, it doesn't. Yeah. It's an abstract concept. Right. It's a metaphor.
The concept that we have a free market that respects property rights doesn't exist. The concept that we have a free market that respects property rights does not exist.
No, I don't think that that's the concept, though. I think
what's the concept of a free market?
Free market is the ability for individuals to compete, and for like what has happened, where we have markets in Asia, even planned economies in Asia, that are outperforming us economically. Because they have individuals who are willing to work for far less. And
what's the difference between a free market, then, you're saying, and a state-controlled market? You're saying the difference is that individuals here can compete? They don't. Well, the thing is, I can't compete because I have to ask permission from the government to use my own resources to cut hair, for example. That's not competing. That infringes on my ability to compete, right? If I don't have that piece of paper, they will threaten me if they find out that I'm cutting people's hair and throw me into a cage. That doesn't say that I have the freedom to compete at all in any way that denotes that.
I think the concept of cosmetology license is that kind of insight.
It's the worst thing you can do for poor people trying to compete in a market entrepreneurially, especially the well-educated and low-income folks. You have to shampoo 300 hours of training just to wash hair in some states. To wash hair. 300 hours of training.
And I'm not arguing the government as it is right now. I am very radical in my belief of reformation.
But you do not have the freedom to compete. If you have the freedom to compete, you will not have to ask permission to do what you will with your own resources and how you
trade. I recognize that, like I said, that those aspects of society, I recognize them as being misshapen.
And you either have the freedom or you do not.
Well, no, I think that any kind of law, in effect, is an infringement of another one's rights in the interest of protecting the rights of many. That's like, don't kill this person. That's a law that prevents me from exercising my liberty and my freedom to point a gun at somebody and pull the trigger because it infringes on their individual rights. Every single aspect of law or of a rule in general is going to be a infringement of one individual's rights in the interest of protecting the rights of others.
But laws have to be universal.
No, right? They don't. I don't think so.
Then they can't be called laws. Then those are called preferences. Right.
I think that laws, like the way laws can be applied in individual situations through courts and through judges and through juries. I mean, jury nullification. In America, we're not allowed to talk about it, and that's another thing I think it needs to change. I think that juries need to have the right to say, well, this law was broken, but I understand the circumstances, and it makes sense, and in this situation, I don't think that it's prudent to punish this person for the same law.
Well, that'll be up to the victim, right? Because if there's no victim, there's no crime committed.
Well, I mean, the victim...
Who's the victim?
What I'm saying, in that situation, I don't think it is up to the victim. I think that it's up to the jury or it's up to the judges.
If they want to go to a jury trial, sure. But when some of these cases that people do go to court for, there is no victim involved. The victim is government, this abstract term, right, that abstractly doesn't exist because only individual people exist, right? So it's up to the victim to seek out the reparations, up to the victim then to see out what kind of maybe perhaps punishment in accordance to make them whole again.
Right.
So dictate. And that's not what you have here. Especially like, again, when we talk about laws have to be universal. Like law of gravity has to be universal, right? Thermodynamics has to be universal. can't exist in a particular set of places. Slavery is wrong and immoral, you would say, right?
Yeah.
And that's applicable all over the place. At any time, we will condemn slavery today as we would in the past 1,000 years ago, even in Greece, right?
That's bringing up slavery is another thing. You know, there's look in the year 2000 when George W. Bush was elected in the state of Alabama, I believe it was. I want to say Alabama. It's either Alabama, Mississippi. They had a voter referendum to eliminate old laws from the books. The main one that was being removed was the concept of the anti-miscegenation law, like. A law that banned interracial marriage was still on the books in Alabama, where I'm 90% sure it was Alabama. And in that election, I think it was 40 to 43, something like that, percent of Alabama voters voted to keep anti-miscegenation laws on the book. Like, they wanted these laws banning interracial marriage. And I think that that's a pretty profound statement. I think that in our society, we support slavery still, consistently. Like, every time somebody goes and buys Folgers coffee, or, you know, some junk coffee brand, you know, they support slavery in a place that's far enough away from here that we don't really care about it that much. You know, the free market, I think, by itself, has so little morality to it that
there's no free market.
No, again. This is the same thing that would happen in an anarchic society. I see no way that there's any kind of differentiation. I think that as price being king,
who takes price though?
The consumers,
right?
And that's the thing though. The consumers
are kings.
Stupid.
Well, no, I'm not going to belittle another person.
No. The average American is unbelievably ignorant and willfully ignorant. You know,
but what do you think is going to happen when you go over 12,000 hours through public indoctrination camps? It's not going to exactly turn you to the brightest person ever.
Oh, no, God, no. God, no.
Right.
But the fact of the matter is these people, like, are willing to go through that stuff because they're undereducated. And we have, like, these situations where these capitalistic reinforcements of education. Education is the path to knowledge and to self-improvement. Without education, an individual is unable to improve themselves substantially, in my opinion. I think, or not unable, but it severely hampers their ability to improve themselves. And you look at, we have a capitalistic approach to education in this country.
We absolutely do.
Because
these are government
where rich communities have rich schools and are educated richly, and poor communities have poor schools and are educated poorly.
These are government schools.
But I understand that.
Yeah, that's not capitalistic. Capitalistic, you can say, also respect for property rights. These government schools have no respect for property rights. They'll throw you into a cage for altruism if you don't show up to your prison daily retreat for a couple hours a day.
I was homeschooled. I don't know. I could go to
private schools. That's beautiful. That's great that you were homeschooled. That's the way a lot of things should be.
But I know it was terrible. It's absolutely...
Your parents did a bad job?
Well, no, I mean, anybody who... two people, or one person, realistically, in most homeschool situations, does not have the knowledge to educate a child properly.
There's tutors out there that you hire to
absolutely.
Do that.
Oh, absolutely. If you have the economic ability to do so, for sure. But that still propagates the old situation.
Well, economic ability would definitely be there if nearly half your income is not robbed from you. Through taxation.
Poor people don't have any of their income robbed.
Really? So you're
going to
tell them that when they receive a paycheck, that all that money that they take from withholding tax, you can tell them, well, it's not nothing. It's not yours.
If you have kids and you're below the poverty line in America, you don't pay income taxes.
It's like
45% of Americans don't pay income taxes.
So you're telling them then the check that you receive for the whole of this government taxes.
It's withheld, but it's returned.
Is robbed from you. What do you mean return?
Tax returns.
Who are you to dictate to them that you don't need this money now because you're poor and on a tight budget and you have kids and you're on a poverty threshold level, but no.
The problem is that you're supposing that the only thing holding these people back from sending their children to elaborate, wealthy schools is the 20% that's withheld from their paychecks.
It adds up. Because it's not just that. Because the employers have to match that, which means that could have been something that they could have given to them. Also, sales tax for every product and good that they purchase, right? Those add up. local city, federal state, withholding tax.
But it doesn't add up to enough to... Because you cannot dictate to another what they need or don't need. You remove this burden of taxation.
Yes.
Then you have millions of other burdens all of a sudden. The burden of private roads, having to pay to drive down the road.
Right, great. So
the burden of having to pay for somebody to protect you from being robbed. The burden of having to pay.
You don't have that protection today.
No, it doesn't exist.
No, you do not.
If somebody breaks in that door, I can call the cops and they arrest them.
Facts have shown through many Supreme Court rulings. The decrees that said there is no obligation to protect your life, liberty, or property. It does not exist.
That's an abstract interpretation of
many
these
of them,
rulings.
That's what they say.
I disagree with that interpretation wholeheartedly. I can't emphasize enough how
there's no obligation to protect you.
Absolutely. There's no obligation. Like, the police are not obligated to protect every single person because that would put them in a position of liability.
Yeah.
Because they can't.
Well,
nobody
great.
Can.
Well, then allow the market to compete to allow many people to provide those services. Right?
The fact is you're characterizing the police as if I was being robbed, as if they would do absolutely nothing about it.
Well, first they have to rob you. Before they want to come here to protect it from people robbed, right? First, they have to rob you of your property, your taxes, before they say we're here to protect
and
you.
We can argue that later, but that's not the point.
I think that's a fundamental point. If you're going to say that they're here to protect you, right, to address, they first have to rob you of your property before they can make even a claim otherwise that we're here to protect you.
What I'm fundamentally getting at is you're saying that this small percentage of, well, not really small, but it's like, is it a minor percentage of a person's
income? Another tax would be fiat currency, losing 97% of your value. Hurts the poor, the worst. No incentive to save. Every dollar you hide under your bed mattress continues to depreciate in worthlessness.
Well, that's why you don't invest in money.
No, that's why you don't have a monopoly on currency.
Well, that's right. But, I mean, if you're poor, you can still invest in other things, too. There's nothing. You're going to tell the poor,
hey, it's worthless, but invest in something else because government is not going to allow you to compete and provide other kinds of currency. Or like
I can invest in gold. I can invest in silver. I can invest in Bitcoin.
That's not the point.
What is the point?
The poor, they're forced to trade in these particular currency. No one's allowed to compete in any other currency. The Liberty Dollar, which was trying to come out a couple years ago, backed by silver and gold. Government came in, IRS, stole all his property, threw him in a cage. How dare you compete with the U.S. dollar?
The problem is, like I'm saying before, that these small percentages would be given back to everybody equally.
Yeah.
So ostensibly, every single individual would be still on the exact same footing they were at the end. The whole society would now have this larger number. So it was basically a de facto inflation of wealth immediately. But then you'd also have to calculate the immeasurable payment that you'd have to be putting out for all these other various services. These services that have to market themselves, so they charge way more than what the government can provide.
But the government,
because the government has the tacit support of everyone. They have.
You don't have any choice.
They have a captive audience of sorts for their funding. So, without that, you're going to be paying. Look at
businesses already build roads. The government doesn't build anything to begin with. Businesses do.
Okay.
Government steals their money, takes it to their friends that are politically connected. And they're the ones who build roads. Government doesn't build anything. Everything government gets or takes away or says that they created was taken from someone else. They do not build roads at all.
Government builds roads
through
eminent domain.
They do not build roads.
They steal from eminent domain
and they contract to businesses to build it.
And
my friends working with these businesses.
That's another example, though, of necessary evil.
No. That shows you that without government, who will build the roads? The same businesses, and now a market about their businesses to put a flat thing on the ground, which is not a complicated thing at all.
It is insanely complicated.
You're
going to
say
you
that
to deal with
versus
the property rights of millions
building
of people.
Copyrights.
Property rights of millions of people. When you want to build a road through, that make a straight road.
Yeah.
Good luck.
You've never been to Disney World. You've never been to a
Disney
shopping
World
mall.
Disney World is one individual's
you've never
property.
You've never been to a shopping mall. Those are roads.
Disney
right?
World and shopping malls
yeah.
are one individual's
about,
property.
About a gated community, like a 55 and older senior home in Florida. Or
that,
a
that's
community.
A planned
Those are roads,
community.
Right?
That's a planned
that's
community.
That's kind of how these things are going.
That's what
work.
A government is.
No, the government is not.
They have contractors who plan these communities. They own all that land. They build the roads. They build the houses, and then they sell the houses on those roads.
Well,
we have
entity,
a society that's already
fictional
built.
Entity doesn't own anything.
We have
right?
a society that's already built, and we have individuals who already have property. And if you want to build a road now, you have to...
That's
insane.
No,
that's absolutely crazy.
That's because you are not an entrepreneur and you do not know how to provide these services. That's what it tells me. Do not restrict the freedom of other people who can. What? Do not point guns at them and tell you, well, you cannot create a road, a flat thing on the ground. Because that's what you're saying, that the only people who can do it is this magical word called government.
Only people that can do it are people who have leverage of force, who can... You know, like, we have this high-speed rail issue that's going on in Ashland right now. There's a high-speed rail proposal that's going from Richmond to Washington, D.C., which service hundreds of thousands of people, if not millions of people a year. Incredibly huge boon for local economies. And we have a bunch of hill folk in Ashland who live on large swaths of vastly useless land that... It's unutilized, but they want to have it. They don't want any kind of source of noise anywhere near their land, and they're going to basically cause this massive social inconvenience for millions of people because they don't want to hear a train in that.
So what does that mean? That you're willing to take a gun and go on their property?
It's not
and threaten
their
life to get off of it.
The reality is the use of force will probably never even be.
That's how it works. What happens if they don't? If government says eminent domain, this belongs to us, and they don't get off the property,
then they're moved.
How are they moved?
By force.
By force. And what happens if they resist?
What happens if they use force?
No. What happens if the individuals who live on that land?
They're overpowered.
Then strangers, right? Say strangers they've never met. So
they're overpowered.
What happens if they resist? Not overpowered.
They'll be overpowered.
What do you mean by overpowered? What mean by overpowered?
How many cases of eminent domain have resulted in death? What
do you mean by overpowered? If I live here in my home and a stranger says this belongs to me now and they're going to try to come and take my home, if I try to resist,
they're not going to take your home. They'll pay you a fair price.
Is that the problem?
Because that means that there is literally no way for a functional society or a productive society to produce. A productive society sometimes has to overrule
an individual. But a society is made up of individual people. So you're saying that it's okay.
Millions of individuals.
So it's okay then.
The needs of the many outweigh the needs of the few.
Right. So as long as me and my friends, we have to apply that universal. You're saying that is a good thing. If me and my friends outnumber you, it's okay for us then to do what we will with you and your property. To hurt you and overpower you.
It's not that.
Why
no,
not?
That doesn't. That's not the.
It benefits us at your expense, and that should be okay for any group of people to an individual.
It benefits. It's not about partisanship. It's not about it benefits me and my friends.
That's what
it benefits this community. It benefits the giant community that surrounds us.
Who makes that choice? A decision on
the government.
The government. So
the
you're
elected
saying
representatives.
That they have explicit consent from everyone around them to say that we all want that land and you should gang up on this individual to murder and violate his consent.
And if you dislike the opinion or the way that government has functioned, you are free to vote for someone else.
No.
And elect someone else into that position who better represents your
No. There's no contractual evidence. There's no factual evidence of a contractual relationship with government. All they are is these strangers who come into your life and tell you what you can and cannot do with your property.
You're thinking about government such an abstract...
It's a criminal game.
I would say... I would argue, like, quasi, just, like, farcical manner. It's a fundamental mischaracterization of government, because... What you're advocating for is hundreds of micro states. Government is any.
We call them a state or a government.
Government.
We call it a free society.
That's fine, but they're all states. They all have power.
Now, none of these people advocate, right?
They can
for
all
the initiation
flex,
of force.
They can all use their power, and instead of
power?
Instead of you using your power as a voting citizen, you'd use your power of economic motivation to make change.
There's no such thing as a citizen either, right? A citizen is defined as the government will provide you protection.
Disagree with that.
No, even by definition, the government says, in return for your allegiance, right, we will provide you protection. When Supreme Courts and their own government rulers have said that there is no protection, there is thus no such thing as political allegiance. There is no such thing then as a citizen.
I'd have to see that stuff. I don't know. I have no idea what you're talking about with that. But
a citizen, what makes a citizen? Right? You provide allegiance to a body politic, for the government, right? You surrender certain rights, and in return, mm-hmm. they provide you protection. Yes. Right?
Well, they provide you protection, services, infrastructure.
When there is no obligation, then, to provide any of that. Therefore, that means that there is no such thing as political allegiance. It nulls and nullifies it all. Therefore, it means there is no such thing as citizens. Under government, you're a tax slave.
But I'm arguing that there is an obligation, because if you do...
When government says in court rulings, Supreme Court rulings, that there is none...
There is, though, and that's the problem.
No. Facts and evidence say there are none.
See, what you're taking here is you're taking rulings which are limiting liability for individuals.
They're not saying
liability. You're saying that the government has absolutely no... And it's absolutely ridiculous to say that, because the government, of course, has liability. If I don't enjoy... The or appreciate or respect or agree with the decisions that my government's making, I am free to vote for someone else who better represents
my
will.
There's no liability involved in that. There is
no
obligation.
No, you're talking about, like, you say that there's, you said before, I don't know if you said today, but you were talking about, I'm assuming this is what you're referring to, is these Supreme Court rulings that say the police are not obligated to protect your property. And that is true, because the police... are not obligated to do anything. They have the option of sacrificing your property if they believe that the actions that someone else is taking, or that the actions they would take might harm other people in the effort. So they are not required to protect your property. They're required to protect the community. And they're
part of the community, though.
They have to. They are.
Aren't you the part of the community? So they have
absolutely.
To protect you. Then,
yeah,
right?
but if let's say this is a trolley question here.
No.
They say you sacrifice that one person or sacrifice these five people, and you have to, like, once again, it's a matter of the needs of the many outweigh the needs of the few.
The greatest good for the majority is also the greatest evil for the minority. You cannot no longer say that you're advocating for good. When at the same time...
Oh, I'm not advertising...
But that's what utilitarianism is.
Oh,
right, and then you call it for what it is. You advocate for the greatest amount of preference. A preference.
The greatest good,
onto
yes.
The minority.
I
there's not good. It can't be good. If it's there's
I
evil...
I disagree, though.
No. If it's the greatest... this is a self-contradicting statement. If you're advocating for the greatest good for the majority, it's also the greatest evil that it produces at the same time for the minority. So
right.
It can't be good at all, then. What it is, then, because it has to be universal. It has to be good for everyone. Right. But it's not. It's also the greatest evil for the minority. Or it's like cannabis laws. Therefore, what it really is then is the greatest amount of preferences. It's a preference violently forced onto those who disagree, the minority. That's all. It's a preference that you're violently forced. You cannot claim to be good. You cannot claim that you are challenging for the good, when at the same time it produces the greatest amount of evil for others as well.
Would you say that violence is evil?
Yes, to violate consent, I would say that
right.
is evil.
So is self-defense evil?
Self-defense is not the initiation of force.
I understand, but...
Right, self-defense
is
from
self-defense,
evil?
Being violent to protect from evil, is that...
I wouldn't call it violence. I would call that defensive force.
But it is violence if you
take
another person's
life. We already agreed from the beginning. Violence is defined as placing a person in an involuntary position without their consent of choice.
I didn't agree with that. I agree.
A disagreement in the terms of the definition that violence is not placing a person in an involuntary position without their consent of choice, i.e. rape, murder, theft, and assault, all violation of self-ownership?
I believe those are all violence. Yes,
right.
Those are all examples of
how
violence.
How is self-defense,
self-defense is also a form of violence that is justified to defend oneself from other violence or from potential violence.
You
and
cannot equate the initiation of force and defending yourself from the initiation of force as the same thing. So you're saying rape and lovemaking are the same thing?
Absolutely not. But they
one's
are both
consensual,
sex.
One's coercive.
They're both sex.
One is consensual, one is coercive.
But they're also both sex.
One is rape. So you're saying they're both sex. So you're saying that rape
they're
and lovemaking are the same.
They're not. That's different from sex. The act of putting a penis
well,
in a
sex.
Vagina.
I would say sex. Is
it's
sex,
not consensual
no,
sex.
Sex alone is consensual.
No,
I would
there's,
say sex
there's
alone, no,
non-consensual
the word
sex.
The sex in itself is consensual. Rape,
I disagree.
Rape is coercive.
Non-consensual sex is...
you don't... There's no one who says, we're going to have sex, or let's have sex. No, there's I'm going to rape you, right? There's no, let's have sex.
I would
sex
say that
says,
most
no.
rapists
yeah.
probably say, I'm going to have
sex I think
a
lot
with
of
you.
Violent sociopaths will say, well, we just had sex. No, you raped me. We did not have sex.
Right.
You raped
but,
me.
But what I'm saying is that they're both sex.
No, no. Only people who
one
try to...
consent.
One, no. Only people who appreciate lovemaking will call anything in terms of sex to be consensual. Things that are not consensual is not called sex. That is called rape.
It is rape, but it is sex.
No, it was just somebody...
I mean...
intercourse. You could say a violent intrusion of intercourse, you can say. right? Sexual assault, you can call it that. It's not sex because it's not consensual on both parties. On one party, she would call it rape, not sex.
I'd have to check the definitions, but I'm certain that non-consensual sex is still sex. Regardless, I'm not saying it's good, and I'm not saying.
Well, then you're complaining the two, that you can't complain something that's good. Sex always has to be good, right? Consensual, in the positive side. The opposite of that.
Sometimes.
Well, you can say that, but it was consensual, right? It was just bad sex. It was good sex. It was great sex. If it's coercive, you call that rape. Now,
I think what we're arguing here over, though, is just base definitions.
Definitions are a great place to go. We want to go to a better place.
And
right?
I agree with the current definitions, and you want to make your
own definitions. Most people would agree that, yeah, there's a difference between sex and rape. One
is
sex between consenting
sex
adults.
Is a pretty...
It's redundant.
Non-consensual sex is a pretty established part of the vernacular.
I've never really heard anyone say, we had non-consensual sex. I hear people say, I got raped.
No, I'm not saying that nobody's going to say that. It's a bit of...
Nobody goes out there and says, yeah, we had non-consensual sex. They say, I got sexually assaulted. You can say that.
Yeah,
but
it's still sex. It still has the word sex because it is sexual.
No
acts.
One says that, he sexed me in the woods. No, he raped me in the woods. Right?
Nobody says he sexed me either.
Right. Yeah. We had sex in the woods. Oh, okay. No, he raped me in the woods. Yeah. Right? But again, so there's a difference from the initiation of force and defending yourself from the initiation of force.
Right?
And that is the clear distinction that we kind of have to draw here. The government does not, is predicated on necessarily first initiating force, violating your consent.
Right.
And therefore, these sort of things, the actions the government does then, goes against your moral values to begin with. When you say that you value consent, that you value this interaction between other people,
right.
It must therefore necessarily be advocated against those values to go against you, or attempt to trick you or mislead you into compromising your values.
Okay.
Otherwise, they're not values anymore.
Yeah. Absolutely.
All right. Have you got ready to go somewhere?
Yeah, someone's coming over.
Someone's coming over? Yeah. Okay, well, we'll wrap up as soon as they knock on the door.
Yeah.
Cool. All right. So I guess based on what we have today, if I came to your door, for example, and had a contract that says, well, sometimes I'll provide you security, sometimes I'll provide you Netflix, sometimes I'll provide you internet or whatever, you'll laugh in my face and tell me to hit the street, right? And in the same way that government comes to you, well, sometimes we'll provide you security when we feel like it. Sometimes we'll provide you a service. That's the same kind of matter. If I want security, I need the freedom to pursue that, right? Or to compete and provide that. And in one in which I could hold them liable if they're in violation of the contract.
Right.
Or else I could go somewhere else.
And here's something, like I said, I think that this is a very elegant sounding community. I would love to live in a community like that. With individuals handpicked for my community, people that I like,
yeah.
And people who are like me, like I like you, we're good friends. I think that I have nothing against anything you believe in. I don't think that anything is repugnant in any way or objectionable. I have my issue is, I used to be a libertarian. That was my progression. I went from a cloistered, homeschooled. Drone of a human being into my rebellion stage, which was libertarianism, and then my understanding that, well, libertarianism works with smart people, individuals who know how to act for their best interest, who know how to behave properly in society or in public, and it works really great in these ivory tower type situations, but when you apply it to society writ large, it doesn't work that well, in my opinion, because it becomes a group of people who have no idea how to behave properly in a society, who are complete morons sometimes, or even worse, are actively evil people who are attempting to take your life, your liberty, your property, and who sometimes are smart people who are attempting to take your life, liberty, or property. And that's even more scary, honestly. And I see without a strong central body, I see it's almost impossible to protect against so many individuals who would wish to act against you.
I would say that that is not their natural inclination.
And that's where I think that's where, like, our fundamental disagreement.
Because the thing is, if this is a Thomas Hobbes role, right, then the last thing you want to create is government in which the most evil people can come in and take over, right?
Yeah.
If you're saying that people are natural evils and they're not angels and they're all demons, then the last thing you want to do is create a body of organization in which the demons and evil people can come in and control,
right,
and cause even more mayhem and destruction.
So you're referring to, like, the Jeffersonian perception, like the idea that anarchy would be beautiful if men were angels, or government would not be necessary if men were angels.
I guess you could say that. And I believe very strongly that most people, a majority of people, are moral people, people who are good. And if you have these conversations with them and even ask them the three questions we went through, would you consider it wrong or moral for such and such actions? And they would say, yes, I consider that to be wrong. I believe a majority of people here in Richmond are good people, moral people. They've just been misled into supporting a lot of these practices. Because when government tells them, hey, here's a law, what do you think about it? Legalize it or illegalize it? You're still choosing government. They've never been presented option C, none of the above, and to choose the moral path that does not compromise their principles.
I think the largely moral people often behave immorally when they don't fear repercussion.
Like what?
Like victimless crime. The concept of that, like, you know, the idea of, and you and I, we have fairly similar beliefs regarding intellectual property, but let's forestall them for a minute and go past that and look at, most individuals believe that intellectual property should exist. However, these same individuals that believe intellectual property should exist, they have no problem illegally downloading songs off of, like, Napster, and then off of LimeWire, and then off of uTorrent or BitTorrent or whatever. And these individuals, because they see it as a largely victimless crime, but it is massively disruptive in the end. And yeah, there are, like, I'm not arguing, for it's what I'm making a generalized argument, not that saying that I think that BitTorrenting is immoral in some way, but I believe that, like, you know, individuals, when they feel that they can get away with something, I think they're much more likely to do it.
And again, when we talk about anarchy, we're not talking about no rules. You have rules.
Oh, I understand.
Anarchy,
I understand,
right?
There
so
are rules.
We have, right, so we can have rules against many of these things in which there are consequences laid out, in which they agree to what the consequences are.
Right.
Right. So it's not like they can get away with it. It's like, they'll, you know, why would you move into a community, for example, that is against cannabis and you want to live in there and try to smoke, you know, weed every once in a while? It's like, look, there's one across the river that, you know, caters to that very lifestyle with great people there to move into, right? Why would you move into a community that's opposite of your values?
Yeah.
Right? To kind of get away with and hide in secret. There's no need to be shameful about that.
I personally like that. I like the idea of communities sharing values and stuff like that. My values are socialistic. I believe that sharing communities make better community.
It has to be voluntary, though, right?
I do like the idea of voluntary, obviously, yeah.
Well, that's not good.
But logistics are my main issue, and that my main issue is the practicality of things. Like, how practical is it to say that people would share when it doesn't help them in their best interest, when it doesn't result in something good for them? People point, oh, well, rich people, they give so much. And I'm like, yeah, when you have $1 billion or $1 trillion and you give $1 million away, or not trillion, but you have several billion dollars and you give $1 million away here and there, that's not really creating any kind of serious...
I mean, there's GoFundMe's account for all kinds of stuff. Somebody got like $3,000 just to make like a potato salad. Right? There's
I think that's kind of more satire than anything.
But it shows that, yeah, people will fund things, right? Just start a Kickstarter campaign.
Yeah.
The biggest thing is, don't be an asshole to your friends, right? Of course, yeah, why would someone want to help an asshole who's been jerked to them all their life,
right?
That's where you're nice, you make friends, and that kind of community can help you. A cool thing that happened before the 1960s in terms of sharing, these were called mutual aid societies.
I'm familiar with this
concept,
yeah.
Right, so that provided unemployment insurance, that provided health insurance, that provided a numerous amount of insurance for black African fraternities, for immigrants coming in here, all across the United States, until the government shut it down and ended it, because the last thing they wanted is that kind of independence. So you find in history, though, that these things did exist, and that's something that our organization is going to try to put together probably in a year or two, a mutual aid fund. for our community here as well. But the thing is, you can do a lot more to give or to produce when you're not no longer being restricted what you can and cannot trade and what you can and cannot do. How much of that productivity is taken away from you? That's your life. That's yeah. enslavement, right? What percent is it not enslavement? Is it at 20% when they rob from you, not slavery? Is it 50%? Is it 1%? And at any point that anyone takes from you and tries to enslave you, because you got to go back and work and make those hours up to produce and buy back that thing that right. you.
And like I said, I don't find anything particularly abhorrent about, or abhorrent is such a strong word, but I don't find anything distasteful about anarchy specifically. I question whether it's viable.
Skepticism is healthy, absolutely.
And we don't have any kind of real world examples.
Here's one right now. The essence of anarchy is consent, right? Statism, as its relationship with people, is coercive.
And I understand. I'm talking right here. This is anarchy. A microcosm or whatever.
Only maybe, individual people exist.
But what my issue is what happens if this is actually implemented
yes.
as a sole form of governance? And is there any real example of that occurring in a community?
You can say the Amish have an interesting close example.
But the Amish are still ruled by the federal government of the United States.
Yes, they enslave, right. But you're talking about a community that interacts with each other consensually, voluntarily.
Right.
They know that children cannot give consent to the rules, right? Unlike here, when you're born into it, they say, well, you're now used as collateral to fund Social Security. There are only rules that they have when the child turns into of age. Like, well, when you're like 18, here's the rules. You know, do you accept or not? If you do, the only consequences is social ostracism.
Yeah.
Right? But when we look at anarchy definitionally, you know, it's against political rules, against those who seek to violate consent. Then anarchy, being the opposite of that, is a consent then, right? For pro-individuals who value consent. And right here, and when we went to that freedom gathering, that's a community there that, right, that values consent.
Yeah.
Property rights. No one will ever try to steal from you or hurt you or try to take away from you, right? Value property rights is a big, big thing for all of us. That's your house, that's your money, that's your land, that's your shoes, that's your car.
And I like the idea of it. I have, like I said, it's not, but yeah, I do have skeptical, and it's one thing for us to argue it. I mean, people argued communism for, you know, close to 100 years.
Yeah.
Or at least precursors to communism. Karl Marx didn't just all of a sudden, I got this idea and it's going to be revolutionary in every single aspect. It was a result of other thinkers that led to his thinking, or led to their precursors and everything like that. Society is a continuum, and it's constantly evolving. And I would love to see what happens if this kind of community was built somewhere where there was not a government that overarchingly controls them. You know, the Amish, that's one point. The Amish, they have strict religious laws. The Amish are a theocracy. I would not call them an anarchy. They're a theocracy. They're ruled by religious law.
Well, you can have, well, I would consider that anarchy still. You can have, in these free societies, you want to be all Christians, go for it, right?
Yeah.
You want to be all Catholics, go for it, right? Their rules of theology do not, again, cross around the borders into my living room, right? As long as it's voluntary and consensual and freedom of movement, anyone can leave at any time.
Yeah. My other issue with voluntarism is the concept of voluntary segregation, basically, where individuals just propagate ignorance because they have voluntarily chosen to exclude themselves from other side of the thing.
Let me replace the battery real quick. So do you want to go over the segregation part? Save that for another time?
Save that, yeah.
Yeah. Okay, so, yeah, I will save the other question, segregation part, for another time, because it kind of touches back into what we were talking about earlier, because I kind of want to know who's against me, right? Who's the...
Yeah,
who hates my kind, who hates Latinos... Right. Who hates LGBT people, great, because then I will never patronize and...
Do business with them.
Yeah. Right, right.
That kind of makes sense to me.
Right?
But, yeah, yeah.
Let people who have exhibited racial hatred to go over there, and good luck with the market responding to that. It's like, look, I don't want to be known that I provide services to these racists.
Right.
You know, the market will kind of strangle that kind of bad, I would say, ideas in a way, right? Good luck trying to build from the very beginning in the woods, right? No access. Good luck trying to invade the internet. So you need that worldwide division of labor to kind of create these things that we enjoy today.
Right.
But so I guess in terms of anarchy, though, and you're saying that these are ideas that you see that you do like, right? You don't generally see any problems, I guess, with consensual interactions and finding nonviolent solutions.
Yeah, I think it'd be crazy to say you have issues with consent. Right. That makes you kind of a bad person.
Right? Yeah.
I think that, like, the idea, like, saying, oh, well, what if everybody functioned based only upon consent? That's a beautiful idea. That's beautiful. It's
right.
Wonderful. But, yeah, I don't know. Like I said, feasibility is my question. And I think the interesting is we're moving towards a society where we're going to have to answer these kind of questions. So,
right.
I believe scarcity is disappearing.
That's a fact, though. It can't disappear.
I think it can't. Well,
resources are finite.
Well, if you look at technology, the expansion of technology, recycling, asteroid mining is a possibility within 100 years, basically. It's like, you know, receiving large quantities of resources through asteroid mining.
Sure, yeah.
Self-replication of constructing robots and stuff like that, automated manufacturing.
They still need resources to create the new robots.
Yeah, but those resources can be harvested from the sun, like solar energy. Those resources could be pulled out of space by satellites that are replicated
right.
by individuals
with
replicating
that. Indeed, I would say a free market to get there, because the last time we were out in outer space to the moon was like, what, 1970s, decades ago?
Oh,
and
yeah.
And we had space shuttles crashing and exploding.
And, well, I mean, SpaceX had
but that was,
rockets exploding too.
And
I
most
mean,
of it wasn't on everyone's dime, right? Some of the kind of stuff.
Well, they haven't. They've only done, I think SpaceX has only launched humans like once or twice.
Right.
So, I mean, if they had launched humans recently, we would have had a huge problem.
Right.
But that'd be a fun one too. Wrap this one up.
All right, so I would say, though, in the creation that we want to build a free society, right? I think that's an endeavor in which we want to go to a peaceful future. You know, it kind of starts with what we do now and develop that and heading towards, right? Especially
right.
one that is in alignment with our values and our virtues.
Right.
Right. And we can get there if we make compromises, and which we have evidence has shown in the past history, people trying to achieve freedom through politics has never occurred. No factual
yeah.
evidence to show that politics or government has ever set anyone free. Doesn't exist. Has never happened. You have your relationship with government and people can tell you what you can't kind of do with your life or property, they seek to enslave you still, right? So centuries, people have tried to achieve freedom through politics.
Right.
It has not worked. So what I'm proposing here and here in terms of anarchy is to do something that's never been done before and go the complete opposite route. And that will be the anti-political campaign to actually start from the ground up in our community and build these champions of liberty that do respect property rights. It does value the highest virtue of consent between individual people and just build that together. It's not going to be an overnight thing. That will take time, certainly. But as we know, mathematically, especially with Bitcoin, a fiat currency losing 97% of its value, it's got 3% left to go, and then it's zero time. And then we'll be like Venezuela, you know, we won't have money to make money. And seeing how other European countries are starting to fall, that can only prolong the inevitable, we have now until then, I don't know how long, right, to
right.
prepare for that transition, to... Do we reboot the matrix all over again, or do we do something new and different and transition finally to a free society based on consent?
And that's the question. There, I believe you're right. I believe that all government is a ticking time bomb. You have any kind of rigid, inflexible entity that continues to add to its complexity will eventually become too complex and will fail. The question is when that will happen.
Right.
We're already seeing in our government individuals who are unwilling to be flexible. This inflexibility will lead to breaking. So I think that's an interesting, yeah.
You look at Detroit.
Yeah, but well, Detroit's making a huge comeback now too. But like, I mean, what you're saying, yeah, we're things are going to start over or they're going to change. So
right by the numbers, the liabilities are unsustainable and they collapse. Like Richmond went missing $28.6 million. Don't know where they are. Where's that money?
Oops.
All right, oops. And that just will just continue to escalate and extrapolate
yeah.
from there.
Well, if Donald Trump becomes president, we will very surely see him.
Donald Trump, anyone, really. But yeah, that's where it heads to inevitably.
Yeah.
And that's, I think, the most important thing we can do is kind of
right.
build for that peaceful generation society.
Yeah.
So we'll conclude here and
sounds
maybe
good.
Resume another time.
Sounds good.
Thanks, buddy.
Man.
Yeah, great introduction.
Thanks.
fast, quick fast. I'm ready to mask because of my tormented past. Swallow the pain, follow the mental terrain. It takes a hell of a man nowadays to maintain. Garments bloodstained, face bruised and battered. Eyes reflect agony of dreams that were shattered. It never mattered to the so-called general public about my nation's situation and how we rise above it. And they love it when we self-destruct and kill our own. And the greater responsibility, yes, is still our own. We should know by now that the system's designed for our demise. If we ain't wise, we'll be left behind. The dollar signs rule. But what about the fool who falls victim to the material world?